This year's Rolex Middle Sea Race was challenging. It was fast. Everyone had their foot to the floor and we didn't back off.
We were expecting a nice shorts and t-shirts race and we ended up with something very different.
We couldn't believe it. We thought this is our chance to have a crack at that record.
When you look at those forecasts, it starts running through your mind, how is it going to pan out? You know, what's it going to really look like when you get into 40 knots?
We were full on for 3 days, sending it and pushing as hard as we could.
It's not always easy to get the balance right, and that's why things break on boats, and that's why people break on boats.
This year was this special. This is a thunderstorm, and there are a lot of rain. We are going to remember this race for a really long time.
One of few venues to host an international race of any kind last year, the Royal Malta Yacht Club's entry list for the 42nd edition of its flagship event has again exceeded expectations, numbering 114 committed crews, amateur and professional. After scaling the heights at last year's event by notching the first major offshore line honours win by a Polish boat, Grzegorz Baranowski's crew on I Love Poland start their defence by plumbing the depths with a team-building scuba dive to a wreck in St Elmo Bay.
When you're racing on this yacht, like Volvo 70, you've got a lot of communication, a lot of teamwork. This is a completely different level of communication, of course, because you cannot talk, but also you have to keep an eye on your body. And I think that's an amazing experience and great exercise to build the team spirit.
Baranowski's crew face formidable opposition. Not only has George David Rambler returned, a line honours winner on 5 previous occasions, they also line up against Dmitry Ribolovlev's giant Scorpios at 140 feet, nearly twice their overall length. The third notched arrow is Comanche, also now Russian-owned and stalking the Mediterranean. The 24-hour monohull speed record holder is making her race debut, with her crew, including helmsman Tom Slingsby and navigator Will Oxley, champing at the bit, following the forecast of downwind conditions for almost the entire race. They'll also be meeting Scorpios on the racetrack for the first time. A claimant to their crown as the world's fastest monohull adds considerable spice to proceedings.
It's going to be fast, fast and action-packed. Conditions look really exciting, but record breaking means boat breaking and anything can happen. So a long race, a long way to the finish. To finish first you have to finish.
I think the record's going to fall. It almost has to fall, seems to me. The question will be getting everybody around the race course safe. I expect you're going to see quite a few retirements, but we'll find out when we get out on the race course.
For any crew, the racetrack presents a formidable challenge, arcing north on its anti-clockwise lap of Sicily into the currents of the Strait of Messina and onto the active volcano of Stromboli. The route then heads west to the Egadi Islands before dropping south to round the far-flung outposts of Pantelleria and Lampedusa. Here, the course turns northeast for the South Camino Channel and the finish line in Marsamshed Harbour after 606 challenging nautical miles. Race day, and the sense of expectation in Grand Harbour is palpable among the spectators congregating at every vantage point. Ahead of them, a colourful 7-class starting sequence punctuated only by cannon fire. First to be unleashed are the multi-hulls, a course record also theirs for the taking. Quickest off the line is Riccardo Pavancelli's Mana, closely followed by Maserati Multi-70, skippered by Giovanni Soldini. Next to go are the smallest boats, fighting their way past the Fort St. Angelo wind shadow to pick up the fresh 12-knot southeasterly breeze. Among the boats starting in the class above them is Tom Neen's JPK 1180 Sunrise. A late entrant following an impressive overall win at the Rolex Fastnet race, he returns to Valletta with a vengeance.
I have unfinished business here. This will be our third Middle Sea race. The first one in 2017, I was genuinely scared for most of it. Last time in 2019, we were winning by quite a long way and then made a huge error and threw the race away, really. So we're here to win. Certainly outwin our class. And wouldn't it be amazing if we won overall?
Last year, that distinction was achieved by the Maltese entry Elusive 2 for the second time in a row. Crewed by the Modesta family and friends, the IRC 4 contender may yet have the experience and expertise to land a third title.
To win one time is already an exceptional experience. To win three times is something we could only dream of.
Next to depart are the boats in IRC 3 and IRC 2. Leaving the start line clear for the 15 entries bristling with intent in IRC 1, a substantial penalty awaiting any crew that crosses prematurely.
Our strategy is very conservative at the start. There's not a lot of room, but there's also no opportunity to go back if you're over early. You take a two-hour penalty, you can throw away the race in the first few minutes. So then we'll make sure we get out of the harbour cleanly and then we'll put the foot down.
The speedsters indeed start slowly, but it's not long before they pick up the pace. Clear of the wind shadows, a 55-metre mast reaching beyond the bastions all around her, Scorpios cleaves her way forward through the fleet. Comanche 2 makes ground on the Valletta side of the harbour, the opening skirmishes in a battle that will endure out on the racetrack for hundreds of miles. After a spectacular start, the 42nd Rolex Middle Sea Race is underway, ahead of the fleet, conditions that will test their teamwork, resolve, and seamanship to the very limit. Boats representing 25 nations are taking part in this year's race, but few have sailed quite as far as Viva Mexico. Believed to be the first ever entrant from Mexico, Eric Brockman's young crew are training for next year's ocean race, but also focusing fully on the challenge immediately ahead of them.
I actually just heard great things about the Rolex Middle Sea Race. I've done a lot of racing in my life, but this was one in the bucket list, and for us in Mexico, Malta is quite far away. No, we saw the opportunity to finally have a Mexican entry in this prestigious race. For sure the first day will be the easier part, so you want all the crew to have a very good rest. And then the second day will be the strong downwind conditions, and that's when you want to be at the top of your game. It looks like we selected a good year to be doing this race. The weather looks amazing and we should have a great race.
By early morning on day two, the multi-hulls are well beyond the halfway mark, shattering course records at every waypoint. Nearly 100 nautical miles behind them, the leading monohulls are steaming west along the north coast of Sicily like runaway trains. George David's crew on Rambler are 30 minutes in arrears. David set the current race record on the old 90-foot Rambler in 2007. That mark is now under threat. Ahead of them, less than 5 miles behind Scorpios, Comanche is in her element, reveling in the strong easterlies that have prevailed since the early hours. Comanche has been scorching her name into course record books all over the world ever since her launch in 2014. Scorpios, by contrast, is making only her second competitive appearance, following her line honours win at the Rolex Fastnet race. Her progress still monitored closely by her celebrated designer, Juan Cumajan.
Scorpios is an incredible project and is such a source of pride and satisfaction because it kind of symbolizes in one project a combination of a lot of features that we have been developing through the years, just put in a very big assembly.
One such feature is the asymmetric retracting seafoil housed in the keel compartment midship. When lowered, it helps prevent leeway and reduces displacement.
If we imagine the boat sailing heeled, and you have the canting keel on the side, and you have the aerodynamic force on one direction, somehow somebody needs to create the hydrodynamic force in the other direction. Because you're canting the keel, this keel is not working today anymore. So, but if you put a seafoil which goes around like this, you are basically producing a force which has a lateral component, which is the one that is matching the aerodynamic, but you also have a vertical component, which is the one lifting the boat out of the water and basically contributing to hydrodynamic performance. At the upcoming Rolex Middle Sea, where we're going to be seeing these three crazy boats compete against each other, every boat will have its condition. Comanche will be competitive above 20 knots. Scorpios will be competitive under 20 knots. And the Rambler that has some sort of magic touches every now and again, I think it's going to be quite a battle, because in the Rolex Middle Sea, you have a windy face, a very light air face, a medium air face, and so forth. So they'll be seeing all the colors of the spectrum, and each boat will have its edge at some point.
At the iconic waypoint of Stromboli, there's a challenging start to the morning on first-time entry Viva Mexico. For Eric Brockman's crew, as for many others, the next leg downwind from Stromboli to the Egadi Islands will live long in the memory. Leading the charge west behind Scorpios, Comanche and Rambler is I Love Poland. Grzegorz Baranowski's team resuming their subaquatic existence on their Volvo Open 70. German entry Caro enjoys the same conditions a little further south. Her exhilarated crew muster on the stern for fear the yacht will bury her bow in the heavy swell. Jens Lindner's team on Hyper are just one of the teams surfing their way west behind them. They're later forced to withdraw, but for some of the time at least, they get what they came for. Up ahead around noon, there's a key development as leading monohull Scorpios falters briefly en route to Pantelleria. Delayed by a problem with one of her head sails, she slows, and Comanche slips past to take a narrow lead. Also making all the right moves is the Rolex Fastnet race winner Sunrise, now with a comfortable lead in IRC 5 and pushing hard.
How are you going, TK?
Going good. It's why we go sailing, isn't it? It's quite scary.
Not far behind them, and mounting a challenge as a leading contender in IRC 4, is Elusive 2. They too are turning the corner, backed by the strong easterlies carrying the fleet west at record speeds. Another former Maltese winner of the race is Lee Satariano, currently setting the pace in IRC 3 along with Eno Triple X on RT3. Making up lost ground in a blistering turn of speed alongside them is Francois Bob's crew on Chocolate 3. Currently second in the double-handed category is Ludovic Gerard's Solène for Pure Ocean. His entry represents the Pure Ocean Foundation, an organization funding marine research projects all over the Mediterranean. Among the first to receive backing was the team led by Dr. Marta Ribes in Barcelona, whose work on the capacity of sea sponges to process carbon leached from microplastics takes them to the Medes Islands on the Costa Brava. Host to a rich diversity of life at accessible depths, the islands form an ideal lab in which to assess the impact of both the toxic compounds found in some plastics and the less harmful dissolved organic carbon, which may yet unbalance the ocean's natural carbon cycle.
Sponges are amazing animals. Their main characteristics are that they filter a huge amount of water, and small sponges can filter up to 100 liters per day. So they really have an impact on the ecosystem.
Using VacuSip technology, in collaboration with colleagues at the Blanes Center for Advanced Studies, Dr. Ribes' team can determine how much dissolved organic carbon the sponges can remove, how it's processed, and what it ends up as.
It's a great methodology because it allows us to sample simultaneously the water that comes into the sponges and the water that comes out. So then we know what compounds are trapped by the sponges, what are produced, and also the rates, because we know the pumping rate of the sponges.
Remarkable as they are, the sea sponges offer neither salvation nor a solution to the threat to the ocean posed by plastics and the compounds leaching from them.
Maybe sponges are giving us some extra time to behave better. The solution is just to reduce as much as possible the amount of things that we use in our daily lives. So this is our responsibility and our duty.
Outmaneuvered by Comanche shortly after the turn at Favignana, Fernando Echevarri's crew on Scorpios are trying to get back on terms. It's a futile task. In the strong reaching conditions for which she was designed, Comanche is proving invincible, already several hours ahead of course record pace with less than 100 nautical miles to complete. Mitch Booth's crew will not be the first entry to break the course record. That distinction falls to Jason Carroll's Argo, which crosses the finish line in Marsamshed Harbour to take multi-hull line honours 33 hours, 29 minutes and 28 seconds after the start, smashing the outright course record and obliterating the multi-hull mark set in 2020 by Maserati. By the time Comanche arrives to take monohull line honours some 7 hours later, the lights of St. Paul's have been extinguished, but her performance has set the race alight. Finishing in an elapsed time of just 40 hours, 17 minutes and 30 seconds, Mitch Booth's crew have beaten the old Rambler's long-standing course record by over 7.5 hours and used the favourable conditions to stake a very real claim for the overall title.
It's fantastic to be here on our first outing with the new owner, to take line honours, to take the course record. It's just couldn't ask for anything better. Fantastic achievement by the whole team.
Scorpios finished some 6 hours inside the old record, but they reached the dock an hour and a half after Comanche. By the following day, the mood on Elusive 2 is shared by many other crews, tired and tormented by increasingly patchy winds.
We're just starting day three, and in typical Middle Sea Race fashion, I think we've used every single sail we have on board, and we're actually all quite exhausted. Progress has slowed down a lot now. We're hoping to sail into stronger breeze ahead.
One of the few boats to have so far eluded the potholes in the road is Tom Neen's crew on Sunrise. For this event, they're teaming up with the crew on rival boat Dawn Treader. As in the Rolex Fastnet race, they've again outrun the weather systems, complicating life for boats behind them, but are reluctant to tempt fate after another productive shift.
Just coming into the last evening on Sunrise. The race has gone quite well, but I'm in a much better mood than I was this time yesterday. And I know that there is a chance that we can win another one for all race, which would be amazing. But I'm trying not to think too much about that.
Among the competitors negotiating the entrance to Marsamshed Harbour the following morning is James Neville's Eno Triple X, later confirmed as winners of IRC 3 after finishing just 10 minutes ahead of rivals RT 3 on corrected time. Eric Brockman's crew on Viva Mexico arrive in good shape overnight, like all the arrivals, relief to be home. Some 20 nautical miles down the racetrack, Sunrise is fighting its way into the South Camino Channel, still harboring dreams of completing unfinished business and an historic double.
We think that there's a small chance that we could still make it to be Comanche, but it's pretty slim at this point.
On the final charge down the coast to the line, Tom Neen's crew have less than 15 minutes in hand.
It's this flag here and the flag on the other side.
Hold on, Tom.
Why do we keep doing this to ourselves?
Oh. This race had every single challenge that a Middle Sea race would throw at you. And I mean, the fact that we were sort of chasing Comanche. You know, if you've got the little boat that can and some record-breaking super maxi and we're both competing for the same prize. I think that's what's amazing about this offshore racing thing.
Having already weathered one storm in terms of the demanding conditions out on course, the race is about to be hit by another. With a severe northeasterly gale forecast to hit the eastern coast of Malta in the next 24 hours and concern for the safety of the fleet still at sea, race organizers decide to employ the alternative finish line to avoid the remaining boats having to negotiate increasingly hazardous conditions on approach to the old one in Marsamshed Harbour. Designed to address this eventuality, the alternative finish line is located at the entrance to the South Camino Channel. Invoking this rule has a significant impact on the corrected times at the top of the provisional leaderboard. The boat with the fastest corrected time to that point was Comanche, and in a final twist to an eventful race, it's Mitch Booth's crew who are confirmed as overall winners after their outstanding performance on debut. Having already secured both monohull line honours and the new monohull race record, it's the crowning accomplishment for Comanche, only the third boat to achieve the distinction in the history of the race.
To come away with a triple is very, very rare. I don't think we've ever won anything on handicap on Comanche before. We were very lucky to, you know, get round the corners at the exact right time to pull off the triple victory.
Next time we head down under for the Rolex Sydney Hobart Yacht Race.